Hearing will come to order, and I apologize profusely, Director Kerlikowske, for our votes intervening here and that we couldn't get started on time. But we're like Pavlov's dogs, you know. I mean, when the bells ring, we go. So anyway, thank you so much, and a big welcome to you for coming today. And I want to thank you so much for your service to the American public. You're doing a real good job. And your agency is charged with the extremely difficult task of coordinating multiple federal agencies to address many different drug-related issues at home and abroad. Today, the committee will examine the Office of National Drug Control Policy's fiscal year 2013 budget request and discuss whether the request adequately reflects ONDCP's priorities and objectives. The principal purpose of the Office of National Drug Control Policy is to establish policies, priorities, and objectives for the nation's drug control program through the National Drug Control Strategy and ensure effective coordination of anti-drug programs within the federal government. However, this agency does many other things, such as administer the Drug-Free Communities Program, which works with communities to reduce drug abuse among youth, and the High-Intensity Drug Trafficking Areas Program, which provides assistance to federal, state, local, and tribal law enforcement to reduce drug trafficking and drug production in the United States. The President's fiscal year 2013 budget request for ONDCP totals $342 million, which is a $27 million reduction from 2012. And I'd like to commend you for making sacrifices and finding efficiencies within your budget in these dire fiscal times. This is what we expect from all agencies under our jurisdiction. However, in making reductions, we also expect agencies to prioritize programs that have proven their effectiveness. And I'd be remiss not to point out that most of the savings within the ONDCP budget were found by cutting the HIDA program by almost $40 million. This proposed reduction to the HIDA program has become an annual occurrence, and I can't help but feel like the administration is playing games with Congress, and more specifically OMB, and so we don't necessarily put that blame on ONDCP. Every year, the White House proposes a massive reduction to the HIDA program to fund the specific projects it likes best, like the Youth Anti-Drug Media Campaign, as they did last year, and each year Congress must do the hard work of finding funding to restore this critical program. The support for the HIDA program is real, but this proposed reduction by this and past administrations is a gimmick. So today we will ask, does the budget support programs that demonstrate effectiveness for reducing drug use and its harmful health consequences in the United States? Our nation continues to fight a drug problem that takes lives, brings about violence, and harms our communities and families, and I know that you and your staff are working hard to keep our country safe and healthy. Once again, welcome, Director Kerlikowske. I look forward to your testimony, and with that, I'd like to recognize the subcommittee's ranking member, Serrano, for any opening statement he wishes to make.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to join you in welcoming the director today. The Office of National Drug Control Policy is tasked with coordinating drug control activities across the federal government and shaping the President's policy on drug control. I appreciate your role as a coordinator for the President and how best to reduce harmful drug use in the country. But I'm curious how you coordinate and hopefully not duplicate your efforts with those of the Department of Health and Human Services, the Department of Justice, and elsewhere, with other agencies also working on the reduction of drug use. I'm curious about whether the ONDCP is the best place to fund law enforcement grants and public health campaigns. I'm particularly skeptical since the largest part of your funding goes to high-intensity drug trafficking area grants, which I understand may be redirected by localities to pursue other priorities. In particular, recent controversial activities by the New York City Police Department, including their policy of spying on Muslim Americans, have been partially funded by your agency and your dollars. I'm disappointed and troubled that money intended to reduce drug trafficking was rerouted in this manner. I'm also very concerned that your agency has not done sufficient oversight to make sure that these funds are not misused. The answers given to my staff on this have been insufficient and makes me wonder whether ONDCP should allow this reprogramming of funds. I look forward to getting into these and other concerns in more detail, but for now, I would like to thank you for your service and for appearing before us today.
Thank you so much, Mr. Serrano. I'd now like to recognize Chairman Rogers of the full committee and a tireless advocate for combating drug use.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you for yielding and for your great work on this subcommittee. Director Kerlikowske, thank you for being with us today to discuss your request for ONDCP. You and I have spoken extensively about the drug abuse issues confronting our country, including your three-day visit to my district last year. Drug abuse costs our economy around $193 billion every year. That's more than diabetes or smoking. And your massive chore is to oversee and coordinate our federal response to address both the economic challenges and the human face of drug abuse. As I'm sure you witnessed on your visit to my congressional district last year, drug abuse, particularly prescription drug abuse, has besieged the country, but especially the rural communities, certainly mine. We have parents burying their teenage children, violence sprinkled throughout our otherwise quiet small towns, many counties with 50% of their children living without a parent, our local jails overrun by small and big-time pill pushers. In Kentucky, we're losing 82 people a month to overdoses, which is more than are killed in car accidents. Tragically, our medicine cabinets have become more deadly than our cars. While southern and eastern Kentucky, West Virginia, and Virginia have grappled with this scourge for over a decade, it's popping up in cities, large and small, throughout the country. The abuse and diversion of these otherwise life-sustaining drugs has become our country's fastest-growing drug threat. In 2010, 254 million prescriptions for opioids were filled in the U.S., which is enough painkillers to medicate every American adult around the clock for a month. Under that lens, it's easy to see how this epidemic has eclipsed the combined abuse of heroin and cocaine. I want to applaud you for putting forward our nation's first ever comprehensive plan to reduce prescription drug abuse in the wake of your visit to my state, and I'm proud to have been a partner with you in moving some of these important initiatives across the finish line. Your plan incorporates many of the ideas which I've been advocating for years. We will only be able to tackle the prescription drug abuse epidemic if we address the issue holistically from both the supply and demand sides. In my district, Operation UNITE, which stands for Unlawful Narcotics, Investigations, Treatment, and Education, UNITE, which you're very familiar with, employs such a multi-pronged approach to combat abuse, a model which I think is ripe for replication across the country. To combat demand, UNITE supports treatment programs and drug courts to help once hopeless addicts turn their lives around, and UNITE-funded drug counselors in our schools work to instill in our students the value of living drug-free lives. On the supply side, as you've seen firsthand, law enforcement continues to be an important piece of the puzzle. Operation UNITE has a great number of undercover officers working in some 42 counties who work closely with state and federal law enforcement officials to get drug dealers, big and small, off our streets. In fact, that organization can now count upwards of 4,000 pushers they've put in jail, a 97% conviction rate. Our country's high-intensity drug trafficking area programs, particularly in regions where local police forces are simply overwhelmed, are critical to bringing federal resources to the problem. In Appalachia, the HIDA has proved to be an incredibly valuable asset. As such, I'm concerned that your budget request proposed to reduce funding for HIDA by 16%. Congress has rejected that type of reduction in the past on a bipartisan basis. Don't be surprised if we do so again. One item we agree upon is the value of state-run prescription drug monitoring programs. Monitoring programs track vital prescription data so that doctors and pharmacists know when a prescription is being abused, and investigators can root out perennial prescribers. Thanks to continued congressional support of a Department of Justice-led grant program, 48 states now have authorized PDMPs. I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge the important role that you played, particularly in Georgia, Florida, Maryland, and Montana, to commit and come online in recent years. That's a huge accomplishment, but our work, of course, is not done. In fact, in today's news, Kentucky's governor announced that Kentucky will join some 20 states through the Pharmacies Association hub to link up with other states to share data on who's prescribing too much. The next challenge will be facilitating the secure interstate exchange of data so that we can eliminate once and for all the doctor shopping, not just in the home state, but across the state lines, which has fueled the pill pipeline around our country. Tomorrow, I will join Senators Portman and Whitehouse and the other body in introducing legislation to help facilitate that information exchange, and I hope the administration can support that important effort. I want to especially take a moment to thank you, Mr. Director, for your great work in general, but for your commitment in our Operation Unite in Kentucky, but also for the tremendous summit that will take place in Orlando, Florida. Is it June? In April, next month, highlighting this problem nationwide. And your presence at that summit is drawing all sorts of support across the country who would not be there, I think, but for your commitment to be there and participate. So I thank you for all your great work.
Director Kerlikowski, if you could keep your remarks to 5 minutes or less, that would be terrific, and then we'll have a little bit more time for questions, and I will let Chairman Rogers ask questions first because he's going to have to leave. So welcome, and thank you very much.
I will keep them very short. The panel has an extreme amount of knowledge about this issue, and so let me just rush through them pretty quickly and thank Chairwoman Emerson and Ranking Member Serrano and the members that are here. I'm pleased to talk about our policy. I'm pleased to talk about our budget. ONDCP was created by statute in 1988. We've already heard the very heartfelt comments from members here about the cost to our society, economic, health care, criminal justice. It cuts across every part of this nation, our drug problems. When we announced President Obama's National Drug Control Strategy in 2010, we really thought that that was a community-based prevention program. It integrates evidence-based interventions and treatment, and it recognizes that the only way we're going to be able to deal with this situation is quite holistically, and I appreciate the support that we have had from members of Congress. We updated the strategy in 2011. This year, we will be releasing within the next few weeks the 2012 strategy. Our budget request of $342 million is a decrease of $26.6 million, but we believe that we have programs, plans, and systems in place to accomplish this. And I would say that our own individual small budget for our office has been, we have reduced it voluntarily for the last 3 years. In a row because we really understand and appreciate these very difficult, as does the President, fiscal times. We put a strong emphasis on preventing drug use before it begins. Our budget requests includes several specific programs to reduce drug use and its consequences. I'll be happy to talk about the youth anti-drug media campaign and answer questions around that, because I think the revamping of that program in 2010 completely remade it from perhaps what had been seen in the past. Our drug-free communities program is one that we run in conjunction with our partners at the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Agencies, so it's truly a partnership. And the high-intensity drug trafficking programs, having been a member of the executive board of the HIDA in Seattle, I can tell you that my experience and knowledge, both from the ground level and now as the director of ONDCP, shows that these are very worthwhile programs, and the vast majority of the funding that goes into them is actually provided at the state and local level. And in addition to our responsibilities to develop the strategy, we were also mandated by Congress in the Southwest Border Strategy that it's updated every 2 years, because we think we do a good job of oversight, and we think we do a good job of coordination. That was reinforced when Congress asked and the President approved the fact that we would write the Northern Border Strategy. So thank you very much, Madam Chairman, for allowing me to be here, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, Director Kerlikowske. Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and thank you for letting me go out of turn here, because I do have another meeting I have to get to. Director, we've spoken at length about the value of these monitoring, prescription drug monitoring programs around the country. And obviously, with the interstate traffic in prescription medicine, particularly from Florida, it's important that the state-run monitoring programs link up with each other so that a person in Kentucky, for example, could run across the state line in Tennessee or wherever and get a prescription and not count on the Kentucky program. How important is interoperability among the states, and where are we on that?
We're not as far, Mr. Chairman, as I would like to see us be in the interoperability. I believe Kentucky and Ohio have made probably the greatest strides in sharing information. But I think the recognition from the Department of Justice that we need to be more proactive in making sure that these systems can talk to each other is helpful. The expert panel that deals with this has been particularly good in recommending key pieces of information so that these so that this data can be shared. And I think that the helpful part is that the PDMPs, and by the way, I spoke with the governor of Missouri, and he believes that he is close to achieving that, and we've also seen it just pass out of the Senate in New Hampshire. So hopefully the next time we meet, we'll be talking about all 50 states that make this work, and in interoperability will be one of the areas that we want to see expert systems move more forward in.
There are a couple of, I'll call them hubs, that are in operation now where the interoperability would be channeled through. One is being run by the Department of Justice. I forgot the name of it. Mm-hmm. And another is being run by the National Association of Pharmacy. What?
Pharmacy boards.
And I just a moment ago said that the Kentucky governor just announced that Kentucky's CASPER program was joining the pharmaceutical boards hub. Can you tell us what you think about those hubs and which one would be the best to go to, or how they are operating?
Well, I think the Department of Justice program has been worked on now for several years, in fact, approximately 8 years. There seems to be a great deal of support from the users at the state systems for the pharmacy board, and so we ask the people that we have worked with most closely at the Bureau of Justice Assistance if we could not have a kind of coming together to make these systems supportive of each other, and I think that we're very close to doing that, because everyone recognizes the importance of being able to share the data. when it gets into the technology, which is far beyond my ability to explain, I know there are some details, but I couldn't agree with you more, and I think we're going to make this work.
The press release out of Kentucky's governor's office about Kentucky joining the pharmaceutical boards group said that there were 20 states now who belong to that hub, I think including all of the ones that border Kentucky. If so, that's a head start, is it not, on getting a system nationwide that shares information?
I believe it is, Mr. Chairman. I think that our work and the cooperation that we've received from the Bureau of Justice Assistance will go a long way into putting these programs together to make sure that the data can be shared. You know, as the doctors tell us, it's a patient safety tool.
OxyContin is a wonderful drug for terminal ill cancer patients and the like. It's a 12-hour time-release capsule that is a lifesaver for a lot of people. However, it's easily abused and has been abused unmercifully. FDA says it can be prescribed for moderate to severe pain. Given the extreme addictiveness of OxyContin and the difficulty in kicking the habit, do you think that OxyContin should be only available for severe pain rather than moderate?
You know, Mr. Chairman, I've heard that question addressed to people in the FDA and the true medical professionals in this area, so I don't really think I am particularly qualified to answer that. But I would tell you that I think that the most important thing that I have learned as a lay person, frankly, in coming to this issue, is the importance of education for prescribers. When those physicians tell me how little or, in fact, sometimes nil training and education they get about tolerance, dependence, pain management, et cetera, I've recognized the real importance of mandatory prescriber education, and I think that's a good first step.
Also on OxyContin, the Purdue Pharma, the manufacturer, their patent expires in 2013, and already two or three other manufacturers are talking about manufacturing OxyContin under its original formulation. Since all of the difficulties with OxyContin, Purdue Pharma changed the makeup of the medication so that it's no longer in pill form, easily crushable and abused, but only in gel form, which makes it very difficult to abuse. And yet, if when their patent runs out on the original OxyContin formulation, some companies are talking about manufacturing OxyContin in the old original pill form. What kind of difficulty do you think that might cause?
Well, I think that we've been strong advocates for the pharmaceutical manufacturers who are interested in producing, developing, and selling the pain formulas that are called abuse resistant. I think there's more work that has to be done in that area, and I'm hoping that the kinds of incentives, besides the fact that it saves lives and reduces the abuse, the kinds of incentives that the companies need to produce abuse-resistant formulas will be available to them.
When would that guidance be available?
I think that there are some discussions right now with the Food and Drug Administration regarding this and other parts of Health and Human Services to make this happen also and to move this forward.
Well, it's you know, we had a situation at the outset with OxyContin and Purdue Pharma where profit-driven companies downplayed the addictive qualities and their great healing potential, therefore this problem developed into an epidemic, as the CDC now says. Do you feel confident that we can avoid that when the patent runs out?
I'm not sure that I have as much detailed knowledge to be able to answer that part of the question, but I will tell you that it's something that I'm watching very carefully. People in our office are watching it also very carefully, because as we've made progress in a host of ways in dealing with the prescription drug issue, I think the last thing any of us want to see is easily abused and more widely distributed powerful painkillers, both that are addictive and also lead to the fatalities that we become so familiar with.
Finally, and thank you, Madam Chairman, for being lenient. The DEA, with their recent crackdown in Florida, the pill pipeline, particularly to Kentucky from Broward County, Florida, has certainly slowed dramatically. And I complimented the Attorney General recently on the efforts in the Justice Department to prosecute the pill mill operators, and they've put many in jail. However, now that we've pretty much broken up that hot spot, many of those pill mill operators are moving to other locales, Georgia, Kentucky, Tennessee, and others. In fact, I've got two, to my knowledge, that came from Broward County, Florida, and are operating in my district now. How can we combat this proliferation of the cancer that was in Broward County, Florida?
You know, as we're both so familiar with kind of the epicenter of the pill mill problem in Broward County, and although it did take some period of time for the state of Florida to act in a holistic way on this, I think that what they've done, the requirements about who can own a prescribing a pill mill, whether or not the pill mill in fact can distribute the pills, all of the rules and regulations and ownership provisions that they put in place, I think are probably a pretty good model. And I know that this was one of the issues that Georgia was very concerned about as Florida began to crack down, that we would have a balloon effect. I think the other important part has been the recognition and the attention and the publicity, and I would thank members throughout Congress of this for this, is that people are, a few years ago, I think if we would have talked about a pill mill, people would have wondering what we were talking about and what it was. I don't think I can talk to anyone now that's in a policy or leadership position at the city, county, or state level that isn't familiar with the pill mill issue, and is very quick to put in the rules, regulations, ordinances that are needed to keep them in line and to keep the abuse from spreading.
Well, thank you, Mr. Director, for the great work you're doing. You bring a lot of expertise to this chore, being with your background in Seattle. But you've made a distinct mark on the country with your work. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. It's fascinating. The only time I've ever had one OxyContin was when I broke my arm last year, and it made me so sick I couldn't imagine why anybody would like it. I mean, seriously, made me very, very ill. So Advil worked much better as far as I was concerned. Anyway, I want to talk a little bit, Mr. Director, about in the national drug control budget, there are over 35 governmental entities that receive some funding for the drug control mission. And you all are obviously responsible for the overall national strategy and the budget. I have four questions that I want to ask that you could answer all at once. I think number one is, what type of accountability are these entities providing to ONDCP? Do they all have performance measures? Are they evaluated annually? And do you find them effective and efficient? What efforts have been made to quantify the relative cost effectiveness of the various drug control programs? And then I'd like to know how you coordinate with other agencies such as DOJ, HHS, and Homeland Security.
Thank you. I think that without question that every member of Appropriations and certainly within the President's staff, that without having adequate measures, and without having adequate evaluation, that nobody wants to put taxpayer dollars forth without seeing the fruition and seeing the success. So we have and have put in place a variety of mechanisms, and some have actually been called, and this is a dangerous term, a model program by OMB. But we have a delivery unit. When we put together the President's Drug Control Strategy and we had 116 action items, we put together a system in which all of those different other components that you mentioned, HHS, the Department of Justice, the Department of Education, et cetera, are responsible for reporting back to us on a quarterly basis. And it's a pretty simple system with a red light, a caution light, and a green light if they're doing well or if they need some help and assistance. And I think that the number of accountability systems, the audits of our HIDAs, both performance audits and also financial audits, are very helpful. We know in the media campaign that we've had three peer-reviewed journal articles showing that the revamped campaign has great potential to lead to success. And we know that our drug-free communities and another peer-reviewed journal article show, and I think you're familiar with some of those that exist in your home district, show that kids who have been exposed to the work of the drug-free communities have less chance of being involved in drugs than kids who don't have that benefit. So I would tell you, for a very small shop, about 99 people, we keep a very close eye on a lot of budget money, and the fact that we have reached out to our components to come in and help us design the strategy rather than jamming it down their throat was a way to get their cooperation.
So in other words, the agencies are perhaps developing their own strategies to complement yours, as opposed to you saying this is what we want you to do.
Yeah, I tried that as a police chief and never found it particularly successful. So bringing them in and actually asking them to sit down and work with us over literally days and weeks to develop the overall strategy seems to be working so far.
And that's good. And I remember when Chairman Rogers was the chair of the Homeland Security Subcommittee, and I sat on that as well. He used to haul some of the agencies underneath DHS in and for their quarterly reports, and they got stars if they had done this and got no stars if they had done that. But it made a huge difference when they had to report like that. So I'm pleased to hear you have that kind of a mechanism. How many folks do you have altogether working on the development of your strategy?
We have 94 people in the office, and we have several openings, several that we're hopeful to fill. But it's a range of people from they give us advice from brain scientists to the attorneys to people with backgrounds in pharmacy. It's a wide-ranging group of mostly career staff that are very smart, very dedicated. And really have an interest in reducing this nation's drug problem.
So you pull in most every single person, one way or the other, who works in your office then?
Yeah, it's a small enough place that we can all get together and develop these strategies. And everybody brings a kind of a different perspective. And I think that's what's been evidenced here in this discussion is there is no one way to approach this nation's drug problem. We have to do it across the board.
Well, I appreciate that. Let me talk a little bit about ask you a couple questions about the youth media campaign, and I'm pleased to hear that you all have revamped that. But Congress did zero out the anti-drug media campaign in FY12, and I understand that y'all are using some unobligated balances to keep the campaign going. Can you lay out for us how much funding will be allocated from your unobligated balances this year, FY12, and what activities will be undertaken with that funding?
Sure. There was about $11 million in unobligated budget money, and after the rescission, there's about $6 million left, and that is being used to keep the brand alive above the influence, and it's being used in social media. That amount of money does not buy very much paid media time, but we really think that keeping the fact that above the influence is well recognized by our target audience of 14 to 16-year-olds, it's as well recognized as, in fact, Coca-Cola and Burger King, which actually surprised me. In that group is important, and of course the president's budget request is for $20 million. And I'm just a huge firm believer that our young people need to hear this message about the fact that drugs can cause incredible problems in their lives, and they're certainly not going to get it in the in most of the media, unfortunately, that they see and hear.
So the $6 million that was left over after the rescission, that bought you a lot of exposure in the social media, whether it was Facebook, just every component.
It does. We have about 900,000 followers, but the $6 million kind of keeps the program on life support, and I'm hoping that, I'm very hopeful that we can breathe life back into a message that our kids need to hear.
So, with regard to the $20 million that you all are asking for in FY12, can you tell me what specific outcomes you hope to get from the $20 million investment, and also how many FTEs are tied to this program, please?
We only have, about, and I'd have to ask, about three or four FTEs that would be
two.
Two FTEs that would be tied to the program. I think the most important part has been it's a public, we've dealt with a lot of public-private partnerships, people that really support this. And when we revamp the program, we actually ask a lot of people in the social media world to come in and give us that advice. So I think that the split in the $20 million is certainly follows the congressional direction of making sure that we deal with methamphetamine to the 10%, which would be which would work on keeping older people away from methamphetamine. Then the rest would be split with $10 million going toward our media buys, and then the $6 million or so would be, or the $8 million or so would be spent with social contracts for drug-free communities that want to go forward, people in communities that need technical assistance. You know, we have a toolkit, and sometimes people can't just take the toolkit and make it work in their community without a little help from us. And that's where we'd be spending that other amount.
Is one of your stated goals now, though, rather than fund an entire national level media campaign, but rather to partner with local organizations? Is that what you said?
It actually, at one time, I think under General McCaffrey, when this program was almost $200 million, you could do a lot of these national large media buys. One, we found in our focus groups and listening to other people that young people aren't all that interested in these large media buys. The other part, and I think the ranking member and others have brought this up in the past, that the language and the tone that was used perhaps in his district isn't going to resonate as well in Arizona or in California. So partnering with locals at a host of both public and private partnerships and using social media is, in my estimation, the way to go with this.
Yeah, and I would not disagree. Social media, I think, is far more important for the youth, at least it seems to me, as my grandchildren now get to the age where I'm going to start worrying about at least the older one. Not yet, but a couple of 3 years. But these kids are all on their computers so much now as opposed to watching actual network or cable television. I appreciate that. It'll be interesting to see how outcomes. I mean, I don't know how you necessarily measure outcomes because I'm rather shocked at how much drug use there seems to be, at least in schools where I live. And I don't know if it's because of boredom. I don't know what it is. But any kids I always am asking kids just quietly. I would never ask publicly, do your friends, you know, smoke marijuana or this sort of thing? And I'm rather shocked by it.
Let me give you one ray of hope, though, on this, is that one of the things that was most interesting to me is that when you talk to young people, there's the kind of the perception or understanding like, well, everybody does it. And in fact, everybody doesn't do it. In fact, the vast majority don't do it. And I've seen kids in some of these above the influence groups have these T-shirts of 70% or 77%. And I wasn't sure what that meant. And they said, well, because 77% of the kids in our school don't do drugs, don't touch.
Well, and I'm pleased to hear that. But I just worry about the drug problem, too, in general, not only with the kids. But, you know, we've had many jobs available in my congressional district where people can't pass the drug testing.
And we're seeing that, that's a significant issue. And, you know, it's not one that always, when we think about the jobs and the economy, it's so important that we let young people know that their future work life could be dependent on whether or not they're drug-free.
Indeed. Thank you. Mr. Serrano?
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Director, I'm greatly troubled by the press reports that the New York, New Jersey, had to transfer funds to the NYPD, the New York Police Department. They were then used for activities that don't seem related at all to the mission of the program. It seems that at the very least, we have an accountability problem. ONDCP stance, at least in the press, has been that HIDA and the NYPD are co-located for good reason, and that once the funds are transferred to the NYPD, ONDCP is no longer responsible for them. I would strongly disagree. What can you tell us about this situation and what are you doing to rectify it? Now, let me make one point clear. There is the issue of spying on the Muslim community in general without, as we understand, any proof that any one individual was involved in anything that merited that kind of behavior. One should never put that aside. But I'm going to put that aside for a second. That's an ongoing discussion. I want to stay to the fact that we fight to give HIDA money to fight the drug on war, war on drugs, and it's being used for something else. I repeat, notwithstanding how distasteful that behavior is, it's this part, the part where we give you money and then you use it for something else, that troubles me. Number two. I've been under Chairman Rogers' leadership, I served on Homeland Security. I also had the pleasure and the honor to serve as a ranking member on the Commerce just to stay with him. During that time, and with Chairman Wolf. During the years that I served with them on those committees, and even now, the money that we gave to the FBI and the tons of money that we gave to Homeland Security, and we're talking tons of money, to fight the war on terror, begs the question, why would you take money to fight the drug issue in communities like mine to go spy on a community? Again, that issue is bad enough by itself, but with all that other money available to the FBI, to Homeland Security, and who knows to what other agency, why was this money being used? And how bad do you think it makes us look that we're always fighting to give you that money, and then it's being used for something else?
Ranking Member Serrano, just let me mention a couple things that are particularly unique about the New York HIDA. In looking at the record about within 3 days after the attack in New York and the attack of the Pentagon, it was very clear the White House direction to not just ONDCP and others throughout the United States government that using resources and marshaling resources to identify terrorist groups and potential threats to the nation was important. And ONDCP reported back to the White House that this was being done, that these HIDAs were, because they do such a good job of information sharing, and they have that history of bringing together state, local, tribal, and federal law enforcement, that they would be committed to looking at the terrorist issue also, that they wouldn't have a unique silo around drugs. That was confirmed in the 2006 reauthorization of ONDCP, in which a very small amount of money, provided that it did not detract from the mission of the HIDAs, could also be used. We have, out of the 28 HIDAs, 26 of them report using no funding for any counterterrorism work. The New York, New Jersey HIDA, the vast majority of the people are paid for by at the state and local level. We saw that a very small amount of money may have been used in leased vehicles that are used by some of those investigators and may have been a part of the activities of the NYPD. That being said, just like a lot of other law enforcement grants, we audit them both for performance, we audit them for finances, and we take a look at the amount of money and what their resources are being directed to. And in the New York, New Jersey HIDA, with 24 counties, including all the way to Buffalo, the vast majority of their work, the vast, vast majority of their work is included in drug trafficking issues, not counterterrorism issues.
You say that you know that 26 other HIDAs are not involved in anything other than what we in Congress think their mission is.
Yes.
Well, how would you know that if you didn't know New York was doing what it was doing?
Well, I would tell you that.
Or did you know? Because, see, here's the thing. Okay. You could tell me that the authorizers, that this, we know how that works. But I can tell you that the members of this committee were either totally clueless or just dumb, because we didn't know that that's where money was going. And I don't know that we would have gone along with that, especially when we're appropriators who know how much money is going for that subject, for that issue, in Homeland Security and to the FBI and to other agencies. So, you know, and as one who represents the South Bronx, where the drug issue has always been a problem, I also have a special interest in this because I fight for every dollar I can to fight the war on drugs as I supported all the big dollars to fight the war on terror. And now you're telling me that it's okay to take money from that, from this war, where the money is limited, to help fight that one over there. Well, no. I mean, if there is coordination with agencies, then get it from the FBI. Then get it from Homeland Security. Don't get it from this program. And that, and I think you need to know that that's at the center of the problem in this committee. The other issue is one that will continue to be debated for a long time, and maybe that train left the station already. But I'd like to know, as I sit here in a bipartisan fashion, I mean that sincerely with Joanne Emerson, Representative Emerson, to know if this is what the plan is. And if that's what the plan is, then I'll know what not to support. But I believe that I, not personally, but as a member of this committee, was not told the truth about how this money was being used.
The plan is, and always has been, and will continue to be, that the vast majority of HIDAs, which are clearly supported with state and local dollars, not the federal dollars, would be directed toward anti-drug activities, including some drug prevention measures. The other important part, though, I think to remember is that they have had a long and rich history of working together and sharing information, which after 9/11, if we heard the phrase connect the dots repeatedly, if we heard the fact that the federal government doesn't, law enforcement agencies don't share with state and locals, the HIDAs were an absolute model of having a much longer history of sharing information. And I don't think when we look at drug trafficking groups and drug trafficking organizations or transnational organized crime, that we can just uniquely silo out or separate out the fact that some counterterrorism information, some nexus between drug trafficking organizations.
I agree with you on that. Okay. I'm not a law enforcement person. I agree with you that you're looking at a drug dealer and you find a terrorist. Okay, you hand that information over. But to use money from this program, which has limited resources, to go on a camping trip, as I understand, with people of a certain faith to see if they're up to no good, what does that have to do unless you knew there was a drug dealer in there? So that there's just something here that doesn't sit well. And it's a tough argument for those of us who stand where I stand to make, because right away someone's going to suggest that we're, you know, not against, we're not for the war on terror. Well, my record is clear on that over since September 11th, and it was my city above all that was hit. So I'd be, you know, inhumane and foolish and everything else, not to be supportive. But I'm also in another war in the South Bronx, the war on drugs, which is the one that claims a lot of lives and creates most of the crime in my district. And there's still something that you folks seem to not get straight as to why the outrage over the use of this money. And you're basically telling me that for the most part means that they've got an open door to continue to do this.
Well, I think that the fact that this information that's shared and the fact that in the entire budget of that HIDA, which is about $13 million of federal dollars, is vastly paid for by all of their other state and local and county partners.
Let me ask you one last question on this, because I don't want to drive this to death. But obviously, your answers to me are similar to the answer staff got from staff, and that's not, you're not going to tell me anything you don't want to tell me, and so be it. Maybe there are other ways of finding the truth. But do you ask questions of the localities as to how they use the money, or are they just allowed to do whatever they please?
We do ask questions, and if they have an involvement in different programs, including a very small part in counterterrorism, those reports are also sent to Congress. That information is actually passed on. I would tell you that the number of audits and performance information that we get from these HIDAs is very good, but I would also tell you that it's not our responsibility to lead, direct, and manage or micromanage a HIDA enforcement activity. And the reason is, the beauty of what the design was for is that the people, whether it's the HIDA that's New York or New Jersey or the HIDA where I sat as a police chief on their board, those HIDA directors know the problems best. And that's the direction that they have.
Well, I'm told that we don't get the audits, but that's, again, this is all part of what the problem is here.
Okay.
Maybe the solution is just to change the name of the program to, you know, high drug intensity areas and counterterrorism, and then people like me won't have an argument anymore. But there's something terribly wrong here, and I, Mr. Director, and I don't think your folks in your shop fully understand that this is bigger than it is. That we have, and I'll close with this, Madam Chair. We will hear from the majority party, and this is not an attack on the majority party, it's just that they're in control of the House. A lot of questions asked of the administration and of agencies about how are you spending your money? How are you spending your money? How are you spending your money? And in this area, it seems that no one is concerned of how we're spending the money. Everywhere else is a desire to cut and a desire to bring people on the table, you know, and to explain why they're asking for that kind of money or getting that kind of money and using it for something else. This one really created a big stir. It created a lot of controversy. It created a lot of ill feelings that we have to try to patch up in New York City now to have a better city. And I really don't believe that you folks really understand what went on and how much harm it may have done to not only New York, but to other places. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Serrano. I might, just before I turn into Mr. Womack, Director, over the years we have had difficulty in getting, we have not had good communication with your office. I guess that's just the bottom line. And so when we're putting together our, once we get our funding allocation, we're putting together our budget and making or our appropriations bill and making funding decisions here and there, I just have to ask you if you would perhaps be able to work a little, you and your staff, to work a little closer with us on so that we can make informed decisions. And so any ideas that you would have, and you don't have to answer this now because I really want to turn to Mr. Womack, for improving communications with our committee and working together to improve it, would be greatly appreciated. And I think, you know, it goes to say on behalf of Mr. Serrano and his concerns that, I mean, we really never hear from y'all, and we need to. So thank you very much. Mr. Womack.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman, and thank you, Director Kerlikowske, for appearing today. I want to say for the record how proud I am of our the overall chairman of the committee, Mr. Rogers, for his leadership and his interest in this particular issue, which I consider to be one of our nation's most profound issues. We have a lot of things on our plate. We have a lot of challenges in our country. I don't know of a greater challenge that affects America's next greatest generation than issues relating to drugs. And look, I have a unique perspective on this entire issue because I was a mayor of a city that had a very, very strong relationship with my public schools and the activities of our community. It's part of our overall quality of life. And I saw firsthand as a mayor the impact of drugs on a community and the percentage of the budget that my local law enforcement took out of local law enforcement activities just around the drug or drug-related issues. But the most unique perspective I have is that of a parent of a child who has had an issue. And I got to tell you that from that perspective, nobody wants to go through what my family has gone through and what many, many other millions of families around our country have gone through or are going through or will go through someday regarding this terrible epidemic. My questions are more around kind of philosophical matters. And that is, from my perspective, I believe past behavior is a predictor of future behavior, particularly when it concerns drugs. Philosophically, how much of our strategy is geared toward kind of repeat offenders, you know, knowing that if somebody has acquired, because of the qualities of particularly methamphetamine and some of these prescription drug issues that we've talked about and the addictive characteristics involved, how much of our strategy is, maybe on a percentage basis, is directed toward dealing with individuals that have a known problem and are predisposed perhaps to having those problems over and over and over again? And then I'll come back with questions related to that in terms of sentencing guidelines and this sort of thing.
I think that the most important part has been the recognition by the administration that addiction is a disease, that it's not a moral failing, that it's not a failure to find your God, that it is a brain disease, that it is diagnosable, that it is treatable, that people actually recover. And I have literally met in these 3 years that I've had the job hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people that are doing very well. We know very clearly that the receptors in the brain, and certainly Dr. Volkoff at the National Institute of Drug Abuse and others who lecture and teach about this and do the research, can clearly tell us that there are people that are predisposed to that addiction. And so we have to not only make sure that we have programs available to recognize that early, because the early intervention is the ones that are often most successful, they're the least expensive, and they're the least intrusive. And that's why we've moved to have primary care parts of the health system be much more involved with drug recognition issues. With just a very few questions, a healthcare professional can determine whether or not a person may be headed for a potential problem and therefore have that intervention early before the really bad things begin to happen. We have an Office of Recovery, the first time ONDCP has ever had anyone in that particular position, because we want to get that message out that people can recover and that they can be back being law-abiding, tax-paying community members responsible for their families.
Everybody would agree that abstinence from in the youth community is the best anti-drug, if you will, to not have that situation where you may be predisposed to some kind of an addictive behavior. But how active is your organization in serving as an advisor of counsel to, shall we say, our states at large, in helping them understand? Because I truly believe in my heart that it's not as simple as just punishing an offender and putting them in an incarcerated condition, lock them up, throw away the key mentality, and then one day when they're back out on the street, they will have learned the error of their ways and will no longer conduct themselves in that sort of way. That's not how addictions work. Lock them and throw away the key, but one day when they're out on their own, right, they're right back where they were, because we may have punished them for a manifestation of drug use, i.e. stealing something, a crime against, you know, personal property crime or something like that, stealing in order to get money, in order to buy the drugs to support the habit. All we've done is punish them for those types of behaviors, but we've not addressed the underlying behavior. And I think in a lot of repeat offenders, this is goes to the heart of why we continue to struggle with dealing with this issue. Your thoughts?
Wasn't that many years ago that a discussion like this, we would have been categorized as soft on drugs and soft on crime. There's been a massive sea change for a whole host of reasons, and I think one is, and I'm not exactly sure why, but as a police chief, having been selected to head up the Drug Policy Office, I really deliver a message about prevention and treatment. Someone had once asked me, well, then you're going to be categorized as soft on drugs, but I don't think after 38 years in law enforcement that's an easy label to put on me. I would also tell you that the vast majority of my colleagues, and including prosecutors and judges, all talk about that the criminal justice system and arrest is not going to make this system, this situation better. That it is the investments in prevention, the investments in when the recognition is there of a particular problem. We are a huge help, I think, to the states in a couple ways. One is that I look at governors across the country, Governor Deal in Georgia, Governor Kasich, a number of governors that are moving rapidly to change their state criminal justice systems when it comes to dealing with the drug problems. For a whole host of reasons. And we have worked to get some model programs in place that I think are particularly helpful. Drug market initiative to help people get out of the drug problem before they actually get a criminal arrest record. There are other programs that if a person is on parole or probation, that if they test positive for drugs, that they can be treated very quickly rather than put back into prison to serve the rest of their 5-year or 10-year sentence. These are programs that we strongly advocate for, and I don't find anybody anymore arguing that minimum mandatory criminal justice, throw away the key, is a solution to this nation's complex drug problem, and I appreciate your comments.
Well, count me as one of the people that would before I had encountered the issues on a more of a personal basis, that I was kind of a lock them up, throw away the key, there's the solution to the problem. And when you go through it, you have a little bit of a different perspective of it. And let me just finish by saying this, that there's not enough bed space in correction departments nationwide to deal with this issue if there's not a treatment component in there somewhere. Because we're just going to allow a problem to fester over time, get worse and worse, and with no real meaningful outcome. The last thing I want to ask you about is how have over time, you know, I'm very familiar with the Just Say No campaign of yesteryear, the fifth grade level program, and how have our programs down in the public schools and these areas evolved over time? And are they indeed being advanced earlier and earlier in the grade school, primary school framework?
I would say that the researchers have told me that particularly in the last decade, we have learned more about prevention research and actually what works than at any other time. And so putting those programs forward that actually help young people make decisions. You know, in the days before on our media campaign, it was a bit of a scare tactic this is what will happen to you if you in fact do drugs. With young people today, that actually can be more of an enticement, and all you have to do is to look at the advertisements around extreme sports. The edgier, the more dangerous, the more attractive it becomes. And so in our focus groups and in revamping our media campaign, we clearly learn from a host of these of the researchers that having a program in place that allows young people to know the facts, that the message that's given to them comes from a trusted caregiver like a parent or a teacher or a coach or a law enforcement official, and that making the right decision about substance abuse, not a particular alcohol or marijuana or this, but having the right information about having them be in control and make decisions is the key that they're looking for in order to remain substance free.
Thank you very much for your work in the area, sir. I appreciate that on behalf of a grateful America. And hopefully we can see massive improvement in the near term. With that, Madam Chairwoman, am I
you Thank back? You very much, Mr. Womack. I will say that, you know, one of the things that we have in Missouri, I mean, we may be far, far, far behind on being able to track prescription or some of the components to make methamphetamines and other things through a pharmacy database, but we do have a wonderful program for youth who get caught with drugs and they go into a treatment type of program as opposed to getting locked up. And it's really kind of a national model, if you will. So we're doing one thing right and obviously one thing wrong. Let me go back to the HIDA issue, if I could please, Mr. Director. And I will associate myself with my colleague's remarks to some extent on New York and the fact that funds have gotten siphoned off because we've been very protective of our HIDAs. And certainly for us in Missouri, you know, we're on that, at least my district's on that I-55 corridor. So the drugs come over up the Mexican border, over to Houston, kind of cuts over to New Orleans, and then comes straight up by my house. And we, and I have just spent over, when we had our last break at home, 9th to the 18th of March or something, saw a couple, spent time with some of my law enforcement guys just talking, not only in anticipation of this hearing, but just talking in general about, you know, where we are, particularly with regard to methamphetamine production. And, you know, it's embarrassing for me to have to say that Missouri is, you know, in pretty bad shape with regard to the proliferation of meth labs. We went down for a while. They're kind of coming back now as there's new technology. I mean, I hate to say there's new technology to make methamphetamine, but they shake it up now. You don't have to cook it quite like you used to, and you can do it in a motel room, and that's very frightening to me. So all of our drug task forces, and I have three specific ones in my district, you know, depend a lot on the funding from the HIDAS. So I worry so much about any kind of reduction. And I also know that, you know, the HIDA budget funds programs like the Highway Enforcement Program, Marijuana Eradication Investigation. And so I'm curious if, in fact, your budget numbers stuck, what would be the impact of eliminating money on those types of programs like the highway enforcement, marijuana eradication? I mean, are they not effective? I mean, I'm curious. I'd like your expertise.
Those the $200 million would fund the core services of the HIDAS, and you're exactly right. It would be the expert organizations that are really not part of a particular geographical HIDA, such as domestic highway enforcement, which is the coordination of state and local law enforcement along drug trafficking routes and with information about particular drug traffickers, or the parcel post. We're seeing a lot more shipment of drugs through postal systems, not just the United States postal system, but private postal systems, and so, or package delivery systems. And so those kinds of investigative techniques and the training and things that are done, all of those would be impacted. given that, I think that the core services of the HIDAs are by far in a tough budget year, the ones that need to be put in place. I would not personally want to see those auxiliary services decimated, and I think that there would be some effort on the part of a number of these local entities and others that benefit from them to work in those particular areas. There have been some good lessons learned, but again, in difficult times, it wouldn't be it wouldn't be particularly helpful, quite frankly.
Okay. I understand that currently 20 of the 28 HIDAs, including all of the Southwest border HIDA regions, fund prevention activities. Can you tell me what the exact amount of HIDA program funds that are slated to be used for prevention activities in fiscal years 2012 and 2013?
I think 800, looking right now. Before I give you that answer, let me just mention to you that one of the issues that I saw pretty clearly, both as a member of a HIDA executive board and then coming into this job, was that the HIDAs were not as actively engaged in some of the prevention activities and joined together, for instance, with the drug-free communities that exist and that kind of knowledge. Mm-hmm. And I thought that would be particularly helpful. They also are the ones that are closest to the ground for the kinds of drug threats that they see in a particular area, and so asking them if they would be interested in advocating for taking a small amount of their money and then putting it forward in a prevention program seemed to be pretty useful. But I want to say that I'll get back to you.
Okay, no, that's fine. That's fine. So what programs and activities is the HIDA prevention funding being used for, and what metrics do you have to show that the funds are actually achieving the outcomes you want?
I think, one, it's a bit early to tell you that as far as the outcomes. This was kind of like asking them to dip their toes in the water, mm-hmm. and offering some incentive, which was a small amount of kind of experimental money. So I would tell you that I would have to get back to you with an answer as to how they're doing. But the fact that they applied and were interested in becoming more involved in prevention told me that we were on the right track with this.
So as a former law enforcement officer, are law enforcement organizations good at doing prevention, or, I mean, their expertise generally, I mean, you don't think of it as being necessarily prevention, but are they good at implementing prevention programs?
I would tell you that it's not their expertise, but that they were often not included with a chair at the table. So the difficulty with the law enforcement organizations and having been a police chief is that you really want to be in charge. I mean, they're can-do people. They have an easy-to-remember phone number. And people say, well, let's just give it to them to do. And sometimes because of that can-do attitude, they're not so good at pulling back. So this was an opportunity to say you need to be at the table. You shouldn't be excluded when it comes to prevention. But it really is not something where you should sit at the head of the table. And to show them being involved in prevention activities for a very small amount of time and a small amount of money, I think, is a good step in the right direction in this holistic approach to the drug problem.
Okay. How much money is currently in the unexpended HIDA program fund account that could be subject to reprogramming, number one? Number two, does the HIDA program have any more unexpended funds than usual for a law enforcement program? And if so, if you could explain that for me.
Well, the HIDA program, until we move to the electronic reporting on their finances, mm-hmm. Was a bit slow in actually being able to expend their money. I don't have the figure of the amount of unexpended funds, but I'm certainly happy to give that to you. But I would tell you that once we move to the electronic database system for all of them, they have been better, one, at getting their reports in, and then turn being able to access the funds that have been appropriated through Congress.
Okay, I appreciate that. Any information that you can get to us as a follow-up, we'd like to request that you try to get it to us within 30 days, if that's all right.
Certainly.
Thank you, Mr. Serrano.
Thank you. Let me ask you, how much has been invested in the youth media campaign since its inception? Do we know that?
I don't know, but I'm again happy to give you that information.
Okay, I'd appreciate that. Given the evaluation data to show the effectiveness of the drug-free communities program in reducing youth drug use in funded communities, why is the administration proposing to cut the funding for this program by $3.4 million, which will result in the total number of funded grants in the country being reduced from 679 in 2012 to 644 in the proposed FY13 request? Given that youth drug use is in increasing and this program has shown its effectiveness in lowering the rates, why is it slated for reduction? It seems that this one is working well, and yet we're asking for less money, or you're asking for less money.
I am, and I think that that the clear direction in a really difficult fiscal time across all of our funding, whether it is in our office for the number of people or whether it's in these other programs, has been to come forward with a slight reduction. I think the good news is about the drug-free communities that we would actually be able to add 174, with this funding, 174 new communities, and that's because of the 10-year life cycle of these grants. And so as they age out, many of these programs continue to exist in a way that they've developed after 10 years of sustained funding, even though it's a very small amount at $125,000. They've been able to reach a point where they're sustained through a variety of other mechanisms, both volunteers, public-private partnerships, et cetera. So the bar is high to get in, and but we recognize the difficulty of very tough budgets.
Okay, one last question. Given the rapid escalation of prescription drug abuse and overdose deaths over the past few years, what are you specifically proposing to do to reduce the misuse of prescription drugs? And I know that that's not the easiest question to answer because there are so many problems involved.
I think that that you hit the nail on the head when you said, look, this isn't that there are so many problems involved with prescription drugs. They're coming out of medicine cabinets. Young people don't recognize the dangers. Physicians are not particularly well trained in the areas of prescribing these powerful painkillers. We have not had a very good system in place for people to be able to clean out their medicine cabinets, and our surveys show that about 70% of the abusers get the drugs from a family member or friend or from a medicine cabinet. It's a clear statement when realtors are telling you if you're going to show your house, not only lock up your jewelry, but lock up your medicine cabinet during that time that people are coming through, that we have a serious problem. I think that's why when the president released and we released the prescription drug strategy last year, and the fact that Congress in a bipartisan fashion passed the Safe Drug and Disposal Act and the president signed it, and the fact that the Veterans Administration in the omnibus budget is able to now participate in the prescription drug monitoring plans. I think all of those things coming together, education, enforcement that Chairman Rogers mentioned, are working to reduce the prescription drug problem and to make sure that it's highlighted as what the CDC has called it, a public health epidemic.
Mm-hmm. Do we have, is this an issue just you spoke about, you know, kids have it in the medicine cabinet and so on? How about, is there such a thing in this country as over-medication? In other words, people just getting too many drugs, prescription drugs, especially perhaps people at an older age. And I'm not suggesting that they don't need it, but could this be a problem also?
I think that that clearly I'm not the person to answer that, but I would say that in my last hearing, a number of just last month, a number of members talked about an over-medicated society. And the fact that we have direct-to-consumer marketing when it comes to being able to solve all of our problems through the use of some type of medication. But I probably shouldn't go any further in
right.
answering that.
Neither should I. Okay. Thank you.
Although I would Well, I will say this, that, you know, my mother-in-law, before she passed away, I was her guardian, if you will, and the doctor had her on anti-anxiety, antidepressants, anti-this, anti-that, and I actually went to a pharmacist who's very knowledgeable in kind of doing drug reactions, and we ended up being able to take her off of four of the medications. Not only did it save a lot of money, but she was certainly much better without it, and that's all I'm going to say. But sometimes it's easier to give somebody a pill, I think. Speaking of which, there's a great concern about so many of our young and returning veterans. The Department of Defense estimates that one out of eight active duty military personnel are currently using illegal drugs, and one in nine are abusing prescription drugs. I know that the administration issued a presidential study directive entitled Strengthening Our Military Families January of last year, and you all, under that directive, are emphasizing expanded access to treatment for drug addiction to active duty military and veterans. Can you discuss the specific initiatives that are underway to carry out ONDCP's role under that directive and the time frame for full implementation of those efforts, please?
We can. We had a number of discussions with first General Shinseki and the Veterans Administration, and that, of course, led to the new legislation that allows the VA to participate in these prescription drug monitoring programs. I met with Secretary Gates. We have also had meetings with all of the branch surgeon generals about the prescription drug issue. Admiral Mullen testified about it in the defense budget, in the DOD budget, I think now less than 2 years ago. So a huge amount of attention is being brought to that issue. And there have been a number of pieces of work that have gone on by the military themselves. One, and I think the most hopeful, has been the fact of the recognition of the prescription drug issue in our military. As you know, for I think now close to 30 years, they have tested for illicit drugs, and the illicit drug problem in our active duty military is very, very minimal. But the testing programs that are now underway to also test for prescription drugs and also these new synthetics, which we're mm-hmm. seeing quite a bit of, things like called K2 and Spice that are often sold legally. And so I applaud the House for passing the synthetic bill, and I'm very hopeful that the Senate will agree that these substances need to be banned, particularly because they're described as legal highs. And of course, they're often sold just outside our military bases. And at one of our military colleges, I was able to see within 50 feet of the gate, and I won't name the particular institution, a gas station that was selling these products.
I see them too. It's at convenience stores and the like. It's really scary, and I think what was even scarier is until we had a huge problem in our state, I really had never heard of this before. And then the bath salts and everything else, it's really frightening. So what specific measures will be used to assess the results of your initiatives? Do you have some benchmarks or that sort of thing that you're employing?
You know, I would actually tell you that so much of the direction and the work being done right now is being done in DOD and with the VA. But as you know, General Shinseki is intent on having the rules so that the VA can participate fully in the PDMP. They have been incredibly supportive of making sure that all of these Veterans Administration treatment programs are aware of this new regulation, and many of the physicians there want to participate in the prescription drug monitoring. It just makes no sense that somebody can walk into as a veteran, receive these medications, and then go down the street to a private physician, and the two systems not be able to talk about it. I'd be happy to give you more.
I'd love to get some more information.
What we're doing and the evaluations that will take place.
Thank you. I would appreciate that. And I have one last question. And I don't know, you may have to get back to us on this as well, but I would just like a breakdown of what your staff does. In other words, how many are working on drafting the National Drug Control Strategy? How many are administering HIDA programs, drug free communities? And, you know, how else is your staff, on what other activities is your staff focused, if you could get back to us on that?
Good. Great fielders. They can cut across a lot of different lines, and we use them well. But I'm happy to show the areas of expertise that they have.
Well, it's always nice when people are cross-trained to do lots of things, because it ends up being much more of a team effort. So I appreciate it. I've got some questions that I'd like to put in the record. Do you?
I may have some.
And for the committee members who couldn't come, we're doubled up on hearings all this week and all last week. And we really do appreciate so very much the work that you and your staff does. I mean, it's a labor of love, I know, and it's just so critical. And we thank you for your dedication.
Thank you very much. Thank you.